For my New Year's resolution, I shall be more productive than ever before. I get the feeling I was supposed to do something important. That's future me's problem. Another year, another excuse to gush about new games I played since my last tweet about this very topic that's kinda sorta become a tradition over the years. In spite of 2018 not being exactly as great of a year for gaming as 2017, it still comes pretty damn close. With lots of great games that made us drool rainbows with joy, and other games that turned out to be either shit, disappointing, or disappointing with shit. But I'm here to talk about the good ones. At least, from what I played. Despite having played a shit ton of games in previous years, enough to make top 15s or 16s. In 2018, however, I haven't exactly played as many games as I would have liked. Because A, I'm a broke-ass college student, and B, procrastination continues to tempt me every day. So yeah, this is a top 10 this time. Hopefully with less to work with. This video might come out as early as January, but I wouldn't be surprised if procrastination got in the way like it did last year, and this video is out around halfway through 2019. Let's hope it won't come to that. Anyways, here's my top 10 games I played in 2018. Let's start 2019 with a bang. Several years ago, I got into this fast-paced sci-fi hack and slash series known as Devil May Cry by playing the HD collection on PS3. To get my thoughts on each game, the first one was kinda decent, nothing really special, but it does its job pretty okay considering it's the first game of the series. The second one is absolute trash and one of the worst games I've ever played. And the third one is the best one out of the three and shows the series at its absolute best. So it's no wonder that as soon as I got my own PS4, I went and bought the Devil May Cry 4 Special Edition. And with news of Devil May Cry 5 coming out this year, it seems like a perfect time to talk about it now. Right off the bat, DMC4 gameplay-wise is almost the same as DMC3, especially in terms of difficulty, but even more stylized, fluid, and fast-paced, especially when you can now switch between styles with the push of a button as Dante, and also pull off Nero's Demon Arm, that came out wrong, for some sweet awesome combos. Another great thing about this game are the characters. While Nero is a pretty awesome protagonist and fun to play as, with Johnny Young Bosch voicing him, earning him a few extra points, Dante just steals the show. Every time he's on screen, I can't help but smile as he acts like an handsome, cocky little bastard whenever he's given the spotlight. Because this is a special edition, there are a number of things changed from the original version, like updated graphics and new extra super duper hard difficulty mode for those who thought that Devil May Cry wasn't hard enough. But the best one is the addition of 3 new playable characters, those being Lady, Trish, and Virgil. I will talk more about the game, but I haven't exactly finished the game yet, which is why it's only number 10 on the list. Still, it's a stylishly awesome game from what I played, and hopefully I can finish it just in time for Devil May Cry 5.
What? Oh, who the hell are you?
Glad I got your attention. I was beginning to feel a little ignored.
2018 has been a surprisingly good year for everyone's favorite Blue Bomber, Mega Man. After years of pretending he never existed, Capcom finally decided to bring the spotlight back to Mega Man with Mega Man 11 to everyone's joy. Except me. Because I haven't played it yet. Instead, I played Mega Man X Legacy Collection 1, which also came out last year. Well, to be more specific, I'm just gonna talk about Mega Man X. This is the only game in the collection that I actually finished. I'm also halfway through X2. Despite it being my first time playing a Mega Man game, I already had a basic idea of what kind of game Mega Man X was. You play as a titular Blue Bomber, going through 8 unique stages, each ending with a boss fight against their respective Maverick. These stages are all fun, brilliantly designed to the point that finishing one stage changes a certain aspect about another stage. Like for example, doing Storm Eagle stage first deactivates all the electrical hazards in Spark Mandrill stage, making it a total cakewalk. As for the bosses, the Mavericks you face throughout the game can be pretty tough and challenging, to the point where you die over and over again until you memorize their attack pattern and beat them in a satisfying fashion, getting new weapon upgrades as a reward which can be used to make certain boss fights a lot easier. As for the story? Actually, there's not much of a story in this game. You just go out, kill all 8 Mavericks, go after the mastermind behind the Maverick Uprising, kill the same 8 Mavericks in a boss rush segment, face the true villain, and that's it. It's a relatively simple plot, but I don't mind it, especially since gameplay-wise, it's a fast-paced, challenging, and fun experience. That is, if you don't mind dying over and over again. Seriously, the difficulty here is brutal at times, but still manageable when you know what you're doing. It's overall a great starting point for anyone who wants getting into Mega Man. Remember how in previous lists I loved Pokemon so much that I put every single new entry as number 1 in these kind of lists, and even a few other lists on top of that? Then when Steel's list came and I put Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon at number 3 instead of 1 like I usually do? That was quite a surprise, wasn't it? Especially for me. How about we do it again, but this time it's in the bottom 5 instead of the top 5. At number 8 we have Pokemon Let's Go Pikachu and Eevee, the remake to the very first Pokemon game I've played, Pokemon Yellow. At first, despite the worlds of nostalgia I felt playing this game, I have to admit I wasn't looking too forward to this game, considering it's like the bajillionth time we have a game set in Kanto. Also, they took away wild Pokemon battles and replaced them with Pokemon Go's catching battle mechanic. And things like abilities and held items are non-existent in the game. What's up with that? But after seeing some of this, I got a copy as soon as I got my brand new Switch. Yeah, I'm a sucker for cuteness. I couldn't resist, okay? Anyways, this game is pretty much the series in its purest form, putting more emphasis on that famous slogan, gotta catch 'em all, thanks to the previously mentioned capturing mechanic modeled heavily from Pokemon Go, which is how you get experience points in this game when you're not battling trainers. The motion controls for the capturing mechanic may be a bit iffy at times, but it works pretty well. Considering this is yet another remake of the Gen 1 games, we of course get to revisit Kanto, but with updated graphics and some small changes to make certain moments a bit more memorable. There is one new feature in this game that I actually would love to see in future games, seeing wild Pokemon roaming in the overworld. Kanto honestly looks more full of life now, finding certain Pokemon is a lot easier now, and places like caves are much less annoying to navigate through now that random encounters aren't a thing in this game. This is definitely the best thing about this game. Well, second best. In short, Let's Go Pikachu and Eevee might not be a remake on the same vein and quality as, say, Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire or Heart Gold and Soul Silver, but I still enjoyed it for what it is, and it keeps me entertained long enough until the actual main series Pokemon Switch game comes out later this year.
Well, I'm aware of how goddamn great the Mario series is, and how it saved the video game industry after the Atari disaster. I think it's a bit over.
No! None of that! Shame on you past me. Shame! As you can tell from my previous segment, I have a Switch now! Feels like something I should have told earlier on the list. It's been at least 3 months at the time I was editing this video, and I already fell in love with the Switch, especially with the 3 games I got along with the console, one of which being the number 7 pick, Super Mario Odyssey. In the past, like my earlier flashback showed, I might have called the Mario series as a whole overrated. That was me trying to be different from other content creators, but instead came off as an idiot. I've learned to appreciate the Mario series a lot more, especially with the spin-offs like Super Paper Mario, Mario Kart 8, and Mario & Luigi Superstar Saga. And now that love continues to grow with Odyssey. One of the main things I love about Odyssey is the open world aesthetic similar to 64 and Sunshine, but without the main overworld to get back to after getting a certain collectible, this time being Power Moons. So you still get to stay in the level to look for more Power Moons, which actually works pretty damn well to this game's benefit. Sure, some of the Power Moons end up feeling extra competitive and tedious to collect over time, but with how many Power Moons there actually are in total, I'm surprised that I stayed up until 5 AM several times collecting these things, especially when the game rewards you for thinking outside the box on several occasions. The levels, or kingdoms, are simply put amazing and very creatively designed. My favorites being Cascade Kingdom simply because you get to possess a giant T-Rex to wreck shit up, Cap Kingdom for the Tim Burton style aesthetic, and Metro Kingdom, where being a normal working city with normal working people is oddly enough the weirdest part of this whole game. There's a shit ton of stuff to do in the game. Hell, I haven't even been the main story yet because I keep getting distracted working for more Power Moons. But I've played enough to know this is one of the finest games on the Switch and a great starting point for anyone who recently bought a system. Do you ever get into a game series by watching someone's let's play of it? That's pretty much how I got into Danganronpa, but there's another series that comes to my mind, the Yakuza series. A series where you play as the ultra badass former Yakuza Kazuma Kiryu, as he kicks names and takes ass- wait, what? Kicks ass and takes names, all while taking some time to help innocent people with their personal drama, no matter how ridiculous the situation might get. Hell, some of those situations can be their own anime series with how over the top and ridiculous they are. I'm fell in love with the series the instant I started playing Yakuza 0 back in 2017, and to this day I still love the series a lot, especially the most recent game in the series, the PS4 remake of the second game, Yakuza Kiwami 2. After the events of the first Kiwami, Kiryu now lives a normal life along with his adopted daughter Haruka, until he gets his ass dragged back to the Yakuza world to help the Tojo clan make a truce to their old rival clan, the Omi Alliance, before things get extra ugly and bloody. Also, there's this short side part where you play as Majima doing his own thing and it's amazing because Majima is best boy. Just like the stories in previous Yakuza games, Kiwami 2's story never fails to keep me really invested in the main plot and making me sweat from how intense some moments can get, especially whenever the game's main antagonist Ryuji Goda is on screen. Also, just like previous games, it has a lot of silly fun sub-stories sprinkled all over the place for you to do in case you need to take a moment to wind down from all the intense dramatic stuff from the main story. And these sub-stories can be pretty damn ridiculous, like running a cabaret club, modeling for sexy photo contest, voice acting in a yaoi game, or even... this is a thing. Gameplay-wise, while sad we can no longer switch between different fighting styles like in Zero and the first Kiwami, the combat is still as fun as it ever was, as you literally curb-stomp hordes of thugs in such a brutal and satisfying manner with either your own fists, whatever shit you pick up from your surroundings, or even use your actual surroundings to beat them senseless. Though, don't do it inside convenience stores and fast food restaurants, cause they'll temporarily kick you out for trashing the place. The presentation is astonishingly gorgeous, mostly thanks to the new Dragon Engine adding a lot of detail to the environments, like making almost every object in the game hilariously breakable, and making it possible to seamlessly enter any building without any loading screens to put any dampers on your immersive experience. Overall, Kiwami 2 is every bit of fun as I'd expect from a Yakuza game, even if I haven't exactly finished the game, and with remasters of Yakuza 3, 4, and 5 coming out in the future, I'd say this is a perfect time to get into the series if you're into open world beat-em-up games with great compelling narratives and kick-ass gameplay.
いい戦いぶりだったぞ。
Can I just talk about how the DS had a lot of good adventure, puzzle, and visual novel games in its library? Ace Attorney, Professor Layton, 999. I always found this strange fascination with these type of games, as if a ghost tricked me into playing these games. Get it? Ghost trick? Because that's the game I'm gonna talk about next? Something went better in my head. Anyways, Ghost Trick Phantom Detective as you play as Cecil, a man who dies as soon as the game starts. Well, at least he and Sir Daniel can relate to each other on that aspect. As a ghost, Cecil discovers he can possess several objects and manipulate them at will, and that he can also time travel to 4 minutes before the death of someone who just died recently. By doing this, Cecil can use his newfound ghost powers to prevent these deaths from happening, so he can get one step closer to figuring out how exactly did he die and even his true identity. Oh yeah, Cecil has death-induced amnesia. Did I forget to mention that? All the while, we get to meet a large cast of really interesting and colorful characters who help Cecil whether it's directly or indirectly, including a fluffy little Pomeranian named Missile. He's a good doggo and the best part of the game. The story is pretty good, with several mysteries with a lot of twists and turns that get me engaged all the way as I try to figure out more about Cecil and how he died. Along with a great story, the gameplay is also pretty great and unique as you create your own path by manipulating all sorts of objects to get around the place to save those who recently died. It does involve a lot of trial and error, but considering you can repeat the mission as many times as you want, it's not really a big issue and actually encourages you to figure out what happens when you manipulate certain objects soon moments. Though those last 4 seconds before someone's death can cause a lot of anxiety most of the time to anyone, including myself. Honestly, I could talk more about Ghost Trick, but I'd be spoiling this game for those who haven't played it. So, if you're a fan of Ace Attorney or just visual novels with a lot of puzzle solving, mystery, and murder, I highly recommend this game. It's truly an underappreciated gem in the DS library that not a lot of people got to play when it came out. Poor thing never had a ghost of a chance to be as popular as Ace Attorney. What's with me and ghost buns? Let's check the really, really watched pile of games I got a long time ago, but never touched until very recently. Oh, hello there, infamous Second Son, how have you been? Along with Uncharted 4 and Ratchet & Clank PS4, this game was one of the main reasons why I got myself a PS4, being a fan of the first two Infamous games. Taking place 7 years after the events of Infamous 2, you now play as Delson Rowe, a rebellious young man who by sheer accident finds out he's a conduit, as in the video game equivalent of Marvel's mutants, who can copy the powers of other conduits by simply touching them. After this mind-blowing revelation, a woman named Brooke Augustine arrives and chops concrete shards into Delson's closest friends, making them go through a slow, painful death. So Delson goes to Seattle along with his older brother Reggie to confront Augustine and copy her concrete powers to cure his friends, all while helping other conduits with their problems. The plot is much simpler than in the previous games, but it still manages to keep me engaged, especially when you have someone as charismatic as Delson as the protagonist. One thing I really like about Delson, besides the fact that he's voiced by Troy Baker, is his powers, those being smoke, neon, and video, all of them being very creative, fun, and perfectly complementing the urban setting of Seattle, never letting the game feel more tedious over time, though I kinda wish there was a quick select menu of some kind to switch between powers more efficiently than going through the trouble of searching for a power source for a certain power you want to use, but that's honestly just a nitpick of mine. The game also has a lot of side missions that keep you busy, even if you're not the type of player who 100% everything, including spray painting, destroying hidden cameras, and hunting down secret DUP agents. Honestly, I spent more time doing all the side missions than actually progressing through the main story, either because I really enjoyed doing them, or I'm just easily distracted by side content. Probably both. But all in all, Second Son is a very enjoyable game and a pretty good follow-up to Infamous 2. I highly recommend it to anyone who has a PS4 or is thinking about getting a PS4. You'll be in for quite a ride.
Seem to be getting the hang of your, new symptoms, right? And of course, the only downside being that, nope, can't think of anything. This is pretty freaking awesome.
This was the reason I got a Switch in the first place. So Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, the game that made fanboys everywhere explode with hype by just showing their own logo. And after playing it for hours, I can say it was truly deserving of all the hype. The roster can be summed up by the game's own tagline, "Everyone is here!" As it's composed of every single character that's been in a Smash game at least once, including Wolf, Pichu, Young Link, Ice Climbers, and even Snake. As well as new additions that fans have been waiting forever to see, like Ridley, Simon, and K-Rool. As well as some surprising ones like Victor, Daisy, Piranha Plant, and even Joker from Persona 5! Yep, best fighting game roster ever, no question! As well, the gameplay feels it's pretty damn chaotic, but in a fun kind of way. As fighters can get KO'd as fast as they enter the stage, it gets pretty damn crazy out there. Obviously, multiplayer is where Smash Ultimate is at its best, with many different types of matches like Squad Strike and Smashdown, but there's also plenty of single player content to keep you busy when you're as lonely as I am at times, like the returning Classic mode, and the brand new Spirit Board where you enter matches with very specific conditions based on their respective spirit. Some modes like Home Run Contest and Target Smash are missing as of now, but honestly, besides Smash 1, I never really cared much for any of those modes, but World of Wine actually kept me hooked for quite a long time, with most of the spirit battles being unique from one another and all of them being crazy fun, with some exceptions. Just like my experience with Smash 4, I've been playing Ultimate for like a month, and yet I still have a lot more I want to do in the game, like the hundreds of spirit battles, Classic mode, and All-Star Smash with all the characters. Maybe doing second playthrough of World of Light but on an harder difficulty, there's just a fuck ton of stuff to do in Smash Ultimate and I just can't get my hands off of it. No, you're the ones who have a problem! Hectic, chaotic, addicting, and fun celebration of video game history. That's the best way to describe Smash Ultimate in a nutshell, and considering we're getting more stuff in the future, like possibly new modes and 5 DLC characters and stages including Joker, I don't think I'll ever stop playing Smash Ultimate in the foreseeable future. Though it kinda sucks I now have to buy an online subscription just to play online with my friends. Stupid online subscription service. Good god, 2018 has just been an amazing year for everyone's favorite web-ed Spider-Man, from facing the Mad Titan Thanos in Infinity War with results that left me not feeling too good, to going on a multi-dimensional adventure with several different Spider-Men in Into the Spider-Verse, to having his own game on the PS4, which just so happens to be my number 2 game on this list. Being made by Insomniac Games, the same developers behind the original Spyro trilogy and the Ratchet & Clank games, I knew this game was gonna be spectacular from the moment it was announced. And after I played the first hour of this game and beat the shit out of the Kingpin, it only further reinforced my hype for the game. The story starts off with Spidey doing his usual thing, swinging around New York while helping innocent people and beating up bad guys while struggling to keep his normal life as Peter Parker in check. But later on, goddamn, does the story turn out a lot more interesting than I expected. It even got to the point where I legit cried at the game's ending. Not a lot of games can do that to me. Swinging around the overworld on its own, it's honestly pretty damn exciting, and I never find myself fast traveling between places often simply because the web swinging mechanics are just that good. Since this is an open world sandbox game, of course the overworld is massive and sprinkled with lots of side content, including taking down enemy bases, completing research missions, taking pictures of famous landmarks, collecting backpacks, and more. Enough to distract me from the main story of the game. I'm starting to notice a pattern here. The combat at first looks like it's gonna be a copy and paste of Arkham's combat mechanics, but in actuality, it's like an updated version of those same mechanics, taking full advantage of Spidey's skills and powers, making the combat immensely satisfying and fun. Also adding to the satisfying web-swinging experience are the many spider suits you unlock while playing through the game, all of them being suits Spidey wore in the comic books and movies, and they all come with their own unique special skill that you can equip regardless of what suit you end up wearing, so that you aren't forced to wear a suit they don't care much about for the sake of a special skill we really like. The acting is also superb. Special mention going to Yuri Womantov for giving us the best portrayal of the adorable Peter Parker, as well as the wisecracking, fun-loving Spider-Man. The only thing I didn't really like about this game was the stealth sections where you play as either MJ or Miles Morales, but even then it's not bad enough to take me out from the Ultimate Spider-Man experience. This is hands down the best licensed game I've ever played, and I can't wait to see how they're gonna top all of this in a very possible sequel. So before we go to number one, here are a few honorable mentions. Mario and Luigi Superstar Saga plus Bowser's Minions. A pretty fun little spin-off from what little I played, with some funny dialogue thrown in, especially coming from Farfel, but Odyssey was the better Mario game of the two I played in 2018. Still really good though. Sailor and Kagurashi Novi Versus. It's a Dynasty Warriors like action slash game featuring Ninja Kiwis with big titties. How could I not love that? Consider the number 11 game on this list, Guilty Gear Xrd Revelator. I know this is more of an updated version of the most recent Guilty Gear game, but fuck it. I still had enough fun with it to at least give it a mention. Also, Jacko is best girl. Pokemon Crystal. Yep, it took me this long to actually get the third version of Gen 2. And while I had a lot of fun playing through Gen 2 once again, but with charming little animations for every Pokemon, I just slightly liked Let's Go Pikachu more.
Coming through!
Looking good, Spidey!
Hello, New York! New suit, same old me!
When I talked about Crash and Sync Trilogy in a past video, I also mentioned hoping a certain purple boy would get the same exact treatment.
For this overwriter, take my fucking money now!
And in 2018, Activision was like, fine, here's your damn remake of your stupid dragon. Happy now? And as soon as I got my hands on it, I was like, oh yes, I'm happy! Just like with the Insane Trilogy, I was hyped as fuck ever since Spyro Reunited Trilogy was announced. Since like the original Crash Trilogy, I loved playing the original trilogy ever since I first played Spyro 2 when I was little, and the wait was most definitely worth it. It's amazing how much love, sweat, and tears went into recreating the original trilogy from the ground up, all while recapturing the original trilogy's charm. Even the environments look a lot more beautiful than they did in the original trilogy, due to the more powerful PS4 hardware allowing the developers to add much more detail to the surroundings, making them a lot more memorable. Seriously, I've been drawing rainbows as soon as I got the fireworks factory and saw just how breathtakingly gorgeous it worked. Spyro controls just like how he did in the original trilogy, except now he's a lot smoother, tighter, and more natural to control. All the characters got fantastic redesigns, looking more like anime beauties than the Muppets on a budget they once were in the original trilogy, and even the voice acting is a big improvement. Hell, I'd say the ones that benefited the most from the new redesigns were all the dragons from the first game. In the original, they all looked pretty much the same, but with some weak colors here and there. But in the remake though, each dragon got their own unique design, giving all of them some personality. Enough for me to actually remember who they are. That's one hell of an accomplishment right there. The soundtrack is also really freaking good. But if you're the kind of people who think the soundtrack in the original trilogy was a lot better, then that means you all have shitty. Then you can always switch to the original soundtrack whenever you like, which is something I wish Insane Trilogy also had. Though there are some flaws in the game, like not being able to turn off motion blur, which has been fixed in the most recent update, and occasional glitches that may interfere with 100%ing everything. I never got bothered by any of that. In fact, I was playing this game so much that I managed 100% everything, including skill points and platinum trophies for all three games. I felt like a kid again playing through the Reunited Trilogy, and now that I finished all three games 100%, I'm wondering what's next for our beloved Purple Dragon. Maybe some DLC levels? A new game? A guest appearance in the upcoming CTR remake? Whatever it is, I'm hoping Spyro stays just as relevant as he was back when I was younger, just like his old rival Crash. I'm the Omni-Slayer, and it's hoping 2019 turns out to be a better year for gaming than 2018 was. And judging from the massive pile of games coming out this year, the future is looking very bright right now. Except for my wallet.